what are your earliest memories of charity?
One of my earliest memories of charity, and many people grow up idolizing their dads, and I did in my own way, but I think when it comes to charitable activities, it was my mom who was always my my hero, right? Yeah. She was the idol, because for 35 years now, she's been working with people in palliative care, final stages, just passing out their last days in hospitals, and to be able to be amidst all of that pain and to still be able to give some degree of solace, some degree of love, some degree of just compassion in the last few days, bring them some quality of life, right? Cook something from home and carry it. So I watched my mom do this for so many people, despite the kind of heaviness that it involves, right? The kind of pain and anguish people are in, suffering in hospitals. And I kept watching her do that. And I think that's what created a huge impact in my life, to see that it's so possible. I remember I was going through a phase in my life where I was very, why me, right? And it's funny, because when you get all the success in the world, you're not asking why me. But when things are not going your way, I was going through a difficult time in my personal life. Professional life was kind of also reflecting the same. And my mom just took me once to see kids in palliative care, in cancer, pediatric wing of cancer hospital. And two things I learned that day. One was my problems were nothing. If these kids were 7, 8, 9, have been pulled out of school, their hair's all gone because of chemotherapy, and they can still fight it, I need to shut up and stop whining. The second thing that I learned was what I had as a gift, that this stardom was so much more, because I could make them smile even in that pain. If I walked in and they would just smile, they would light up. And I loved it. I loved the power that that power could create, that
you
could harness the fame in such a positive way. And that's kind of what kick-started my journey.
But even before that, you gave your first salary to pay for the surgery of the girl of a gatekeeper.
That's right. Yeah.
And you went through your highs and lows much after that.
Yes, I did.
So I guess all that glitters is sometimes gold, right?
It was funny, because I remember I had this first salary, big sum of 3 lakh rupees. And I was thinking, what should I invest in? Stocks, shares, bonds, what should I do? And then I see this girl who's 10, 11 years old, her name is Pooja. Mm-hmm. And she had a hole in her heart, and her father just couldn't afford it, he was a watchman. And something just spurred me and said, this is the investment. And still I feel it's the best investment I ever made, because now she's, a lovely young lady, married, kids, a full life. And that gives me immense satisfaction. I went on to do 128 such surgeries and cases post that, and it really inspired me.
So when I heard you at Harvard India a couple of years ago, what really struck me was the fact that you epitomized the fact that charity should be run like a business.
Right.
And you were talking that time about creating multiplexes for the poor, so see movies for 10 rupees or something like that.
Right.
So, the political climate has changed in India. And
yes.
A lot of NGOs have come, a lot of them have been shut down. What is the exciting and challenging part of being a charitable philanthropist and a businessman at the same time, in terms of making charity work? Because a lot of the film actors and other celebrities have always mentioned to me that they write checks, but they don't know where their money goes.
Right.
And so it makes them like really uncomfortable. But you have, prided yourself about being the middleman between bringing money to worthy causes.
Sure. I mean, I've never been a fan of just writing checks and then not knowing where it's going. I remember in 2004 when the tsunami struck, and everybody said, just write a check to the Prime Minister's relief fund like everybody else. But I was on a plane there. And
that's
saying,
when I
mad?
Noticed you. One reads, if you really look at the media on you, there's more of the scandal and less of the scandal. That's all understated. But in 2006, when the tsunami hit, and I saw that you were there,
that's
getting
right.
your hands down and dirty, 3,000 homes were
that's
built,
right.
That's and you went with all these trucks, and you really walked the walk. And that's what impressed me.
That's what also taught me so many things. That's what taught me the impact of one decision. if you take a decision with genuinely selflessness in your heart, then something magical happens. Just the universe conspires. People just come in and then they start supporting you. You imagine that, oh, this is a problem. You put out a problem statement to the universe saying, boss, how am I going to do this? And people just pour in from every side and go like, here's the resource, do it. You know, so it's incredible because everybody wants to do good. But how do you do it? How do you connect to a network of goodness like Ekal? It's magical. Mm-hmm. You're reaching, in the last 6 years that I've been working with Ekal as their ambassador, I've seen them grow from 50,000 schools to 100,000 schools, impacting now 3 million children. Right?
And it kind of ties in with your own focus on Devi, you know, underprivileged girls in Vrindavan, and then also children of, sex workers.
That's right.
Giving them hope. And then, mental illness is now not the domain just of homeless women.
That's right.
You've got, I've seen that you've owned in many cities, but Chennai and Vrindavan were the areas where you were.
No, with Banyan, what you're mentioning was a passion project of Vandana Gopi Kumar. And when she met me, and I realized the actual expanse of what's happening with mentally unstable women and how they're being physically and sexually abused because of something that's, trauma that's triggered mental instability, which is something as simple as, having a certain medicine regimen that can actually, medical regimen that can actually, bring that sanity back in your life, and how easily done it was. And then, of course, Banyan became a great case study that is now being replicated as best practices and recognized by World Health Organization, and they're taking it globally now, even into Africa. So I think scale is what excites me. I don't drink, smoke, do drugs. So my high is impact. I love to see impact. It gives me this kick that, oh my God, we can do this, we can change these many lives. Therefore, Devi. Because educating and empowering those girls, taking them from an emotionally battered childhood to an empowered state, I can't tell you the kick. I mean, I've been blessed with so many awards as an actor, but when I see those girls, when they write to me or when they send me a picture from now, some of them are in America, some of them are in the UK, and they're doing so well. You know, there's 47 girls who've gone overseas, from those little villages in Vrindavan. 14 villages where over 1,000 years of child marriage has been a practice, right, with girls. We managed in the last 12 years to stop that happening. There's no child marriage there anymore. So that kind of is the big thing for me, to be able to create that kind of impact. That's what gives me the high.
So, drug use and mental illness is now on the high, and you've been very candid about going through highs and lows yourself. If there's a message that you want to give, youngsters especially, because the suicide rate has really gone up, what would you advise these young people who are in Punjab is, cesspool now of drug use?
That's right.
And many of the police officers have told me that it can go through generations and it still won't be eradicated. What is the message that you want to give to the youth?
I tell people, nasha wo karo jo utre nahi, right? Daru ka nasha utar jata hai, drugs ka nasha utar jata hai. You get a high and then there's a low after that.
But do you see an apathy?
Do follow a high that doesn't give you that low. There's no coming down. There's no crash after that. And there's so many things in life. Love is a high. Compassion is a high. Creativity is a high. Follow those highs is my trip. And I practice that. I'm not just preaching it. And the other thing when you said about depression. So when I was depressed, I overcame my depression just by being there for other people. And it made me feel empowered. It made me feel that, wow, I did that. I actually helped someone, wiped a tear, made them smile, and it made me feel empowered. It made me feel good, better than any mood-altering drug, right? And that, ever since, I've been through my trials and tribulations. It's all out in the media for people to see. I've been attacked a number of times for multiple things. I've been misunderstood or understood, whatever you want to call it. But it's never broken me. It's never put that kind of impact on me where I felt really sad or depressed, because I really feel the meaning of my life. And I see it every day in the good work that I've been able to do. And that's what I'd like to tell people, that just pick that up. It's so easy. You don't need somebody to sign a prescription.
Right. I talked to Sanjay a few years ago, and he mentioned to me that he tried talking to college students, he went and spoke to people and let me talk about my experience. And there was a sense of apathy like about 10 years ago. Do you think that has changed now when it comes to charity? Because one of the complaints that I'm hearing is that the younger generation of business entrepreneurs are not as charitable as, say, the Tatas or the Ambanis are. What has been your experience because you deal with this?
You know, I think there's two things. There's charity and social impact. I'm a fan of social impact. I'm not a fan of charity. Charity is a traditional thought process. I'm a fan of social impact, where even there are for-profit organizations that are creating social impact. Like I mentor a number of startups. I'm the chief strategy officer on more than 10 startups today. And to me, every one of them, one of the qualifying criteria, aside from them being financially a good bet, has to be social impact. And I've just done something in India, which is the first education financing where students and parents never pay interest. And people ask me, how do you make it work? And I said, it's done 9x in the last 2 years in terms of growth. It's better than any stock market. It's appreciated better than any stock market stock that you can think of. But it's social impact. It's creating, you know, empowering kids to get educated at a high quality and a high standard. And I believe that if you disrupt with that mindset, you can actually create magic. That is what's happening in India today. Like, I met this kid who's created a startup out of something that he figured out, and I'm mentoring him now, was how people who are visually impaired, they use a stick in India.
Right.
But there's no feedback mechanism for something that's not on the ground. So if there's something like a pole or something, it hits them on the head and they get hurt and they bleed. That's such a small thought as a problem, but it impacts crores of people in India alone. And he's created something that just has a range. It's a little sensor. It has a range and it's India friendly in terms of price. And it gives a vibratory feedback into the hand telling you where there is a, you know, there is some sort of a obstacle, whether it's a ditch or whether it's something hanging up there. But this to me is adding quality to the lives of so many people. And it's incredible. Now he's building a startup out of it. So it's just one idea.
But then you have farm and you've given away 25 plus to the CRPF. I mean, you have your fingers in so many different pies.
But social impact, right? When I started building affordable housing, bankers told me, you're crazy. You want to move people from slums and give them swimming pools and clubhouses. And I said, why not? I said, when your driver goes to pick up your kids from all these fancy country clubs and drops them to five-star hotels, and where you spend in a single evening what his whole salary is every month, where he has to remind you to pay him his salary on a monthly basis, you know, to sustain his family, why should he be denied? You know, why shouldn't the business be so smart that you can create swimming pools and clubhouses and yoga and meditation zones for people who are rikshawalas and bhajiwalas? And I did it successfully, and that's the reason why when people said it was a toxic market, we sold 5,000 apartments in 92 days.
You know, it's amazing. I will have to, you know, end the interview now, but we'll continue our conversation hopefully.
Sure.
But you are extremely inspiring. And I think your stardom has been a stepping stone to the real purpose of your life. And I always believe that, that it is in giving that we receive. So all the very best to you, and we look forward to seeing you tonight.
Thank you so much, Kavita.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.